Vignettes, consensus, carbon capture, and COVID. Each one hopefully short and sweet. So consensus, this part of the project, or this is one of a project that I...
Oh, excuse me, Elizabeth, I'm just going to interrupt. It's my duty to alert everyone to the fact that we're being recorded, that this seminar is being recorded. Thank you.
So this part of the three-part talk is was funded by the National Science Foundation. And it's about Oyster Futures, a program that has pretty much wrapped up. And I had such such the honor of working with people from Chesapeake Biological Lab and VIMS and the Florida State Consensus Center on this project, and Horn Point Lab, of course, that's where I'm from, out of UMSES. So oysters. Oysters are important. They're delicious. They're important for food. They're important for jobs. They're important for our cultural heritage here in Maryland. They're important for recreation and water quality at Killeen Bay. So everyone agrees we need more oysters. There's been massive restoration programs trying to bring oysters back from state, private, and nonprofit and federal efforts to try to bring oysters back. But there remains conflict over how exactly to bring the oysters back. And that's created a longstanding controversy in Maryland. And I grew up in Maryland, and it's one of the questions, main questions of my life until this project, of why I know good, honest, hardworking, kind people on all sides of this conflict. Why is there this conflict, and why is it so hard to decide what to do? And this research program answered that personal question for me. So there is this conflict in Maryland. And this question for the program, well, my question for you, actually, is what if stakeholders could agree? What if they could agree about what to do in the Choptank region, in this region in the heart of the Chesapeake, where there's many sanctuaries and questions about what to do? Well, these stakeholders already did agree. They came to consensus, and they are the superheroes of the Oyster Futures Research Program and for Maryland's oyster. And the question is, how did this happen? Well, we use the consensus solutions process, and this process has been under development for 20 years plus in Florida. It's been used for building codes, fisheries science, groundwater issues. And it brings stakeholders together, along with managers and scientists as support staff, and the stakeholders and this group come up with options for management that they submit to the government. And this process is designed to be fair, transparent, powerful, representative, and it provides a respectful place for people to speak their truth to power, and importantly, to each other. So stakeholders are at the center of the process. They propose options and revise options for what to do for management. The stakeholders, managers, and scientists combine their knowledge, and the stakeholders review into a computer model, and then the stakeholders review the model predictions. They propose new options, propose new ways to enhance the model, and that goes around 9 meetings for us until the options with greater than 75% agreement of the stakeholders advance to a package of recommendations. And then there's one vote on the entire package. And our stakeholders voted to for this package of recommendations that they submitted to Maryland Department of Natural Resources. So for the research program, our idea was to test the consensus solution process for developing fishing regulations and restoration policies in the Choptank and Little Choptanks rivers, where there was a 3 large sanctuaries and contention about what to do about the oyster. And this is at the beginning in 2016, the Oyster Futures stakeholders, they decided that first day that their goal was an economically viable, healthy, and sustainable Choptank and Little Choptank rivers, oyster fishery, and ecosystem. 60% of the folks were from industry, and about 50% were agency and environmental. And so this is what the group looked like at the end, most of the same people, and they were still smiling. And voices were not raised. The conversation was respectful and thoughtful, and it was just really impressive and an honor to be part of this. So this is what they look like. They were listening, thinking, and working together. The key points is this process was set up to be consensus driven. The goal was consensus right from the start. And you can see the two facilitators in the upper left who designed this process. It is key to have neutral facilitators. That was important. Of 60% industry, 40% agency and nonprofit. And then the threshold of 75% agreement on each option, and also a rating system where people who didn't like an option were asked why it didn't work and what would make it better. In the end, the whole group really came up with ideas to make things better. And they were backed by science. And you can see here, Mike Wilberg, the lead of the modeling project, who really put the pieces of the model together. He is thinking hard about the questions that are being asked to him, and was able to build a model that the stakeholders agreed to use as they developed their recommendations. So how did the computer model support the process? So the stakeholders decided on the options and outcomes that they wanted to model, like changing or rotating fishing areas, planting shell, spat on shell and reef balls, or restoring reefs. Then we built a computer model that included economics of the fishery, oyster biology, oyster habitat, and water quality. And then the model forecasted into the future 25 years, the outcomes of these different options. Those outcomes were that stakeholders wanted to know how many oysters were going to be there, what the habitat was going to be like, what was the harvest revenue, and how much nitrogen was going to be reduced, among others. And what were those outcomes? Well, I'm going to show just a couple graphs here, and let me orient you. So year is on the x-axis, and percent change from the status quo is on the y-axis. The status quo is if you did nothing, what would happen? And then these options all down the line, in the lines, were different types of options that we simulated on behalf of the stakeholders. And over 100 options were evaluated across the 9 meetings of this project. And the top options are plotted here. They include enhancing enforcement, planting shell, spat on shell and reef balls, restoring reefs, rotating fishing areas, and combining options. So some of these were options that weren't necessarily great performers in the model, but they were so important to the stakeholders that they were included in the final package of recommendations. But here you can see we had a package. There's a bunch of these top options that over 25 years would result in a 44% increase in the number of oysters in this chop tank region. And that's great. They also happen to be the options that combined other options together. And then if we look at, that was the adult oyster abundance. And then if we look at how much harvest you could get, the same options produced as much as 120% increase and sometimes a decrease in the amount of harvest. So there were many ways to help the oyster here, as you can see on the left panel, and many ways also to really help the oyster industry. And then if we bring in the value of nitrogen removal, and we see this is how much nitrogen was removed and the value of it compared to how much it would cost to remove nitrogen on land, basically, that there was a 50% increase with and these combined options had the best performance. So again, there were many ways to help the oyster, the industry, and the environment all at the same time. And so the combined options had the best outcomes. These options increased oyster abundance and harvest. They increased revenue to fishermen and were cost effective. And they increased nitrogen reduction and were cost effective as well. And these options again included restoring, doing large scale restoration, putting shell and spat on shell in the water, and enhancing enforcement and opening some portions of sanctuaries to harvest, and doing some rotating fishing effort. There was a bunch of different types of options. And interestingly, they really performed well when they were combined. So what did the stakeholders decide? They had this package of recommendations that had 25 very specific and very well thought out recommendations that included enhanced enforcement, complete restoration, allow hand tonguing in limited portions of sanctuaries, plant shell and spat on shell, place privately funded reef balls, explore limited entry, and combine the above options, and use the consensus solution process in Maryland. They found that they really like this process. And so how influential were the stakeholders' recommendations? Well, consensus is a new law for oysters in Maryland. This bill passed at the beginning of this year. And, you know, it's the Department of Natural Resources has convened a stakeholder work group with the goal of developing a package of consensus recommendations for enhancing and implementing the fishery management plan of oysters. So this is the power of consensus among stakeholders is truly impressive, and why I say it was an honor to be part of this project. So in conclusion of this part of the story, consensus is possible. Process is important. It can create or alleviate conflict. And this is what I learned, that when people or stakeholder groups are angry, don't blame the stakeholders. Look to the process, look to improve the process, because a process can create or alleviate conflict. And I really am a firm believer in the consensus solution process. Consensus solutions process help create well thought out recommendations with broad stakeholder support, and showed that we can find win-win-win solutions for the oyster, the industry, and the environment. They can be found. And personally for me, what I learned in this is that no one owns the truth, that the tree of truth is three-dimensional. One person on one side might see a knot, and the other person on another side of it sees a smooth surface. And both are right. And we need to all work together to really get as close as we can to what's actually happening so we can make good decisions about it. And respect, listening, and kindness go a long way towards getting towards that truth we're trying to get to together. So I want to thank the Oyster Futures stakeholders, especially. They were the superheroes who came to our workshops on weekends, and that was 9 weekends, and included Super Bowl Sunday. This is how much and how hard these folks worked to come to agreement. And of course, all the support that we had at UMCEs and our funding agencies. And also the Oyster Futures report is on the web. If you just Google Oyster Futures, there's a web page. We're also on Facebook. And I really highly recommend reading that report. There's a lot of wisdom in it. So, So I don't have a good segue really, except for this is what I'm working on next. And this is after Oyster Futures. This was the next big grant that I've had the honor and opportunity to work on. And I really appreciate the Bailey Wildlife Foundation for their vision and support of this project, because this one is close to me. My neighbor has an iris blooming in mid-November. And to me, I've lived in Maryland, and I don't recall ever seeing an iris in November, and climate change is scary, and I believe it's happening. I just don't, this doesn't seem like a Maryland fall to me. So, so with that, let me talk about carbon capture and what we've been able to do with this wonderful group of people in the Coral Defense Project. And these are colleagues from IMET. Oops, I don't know why it's doing that. I'll try not to. I met Chesapeake Biological Lab and Horn Point Lab, of course, and then our colleagues at Salisbury University and Micah and Jeff Blair, again, the facilitator from Oyster Futures. He's down at Florida. So this is the Coral Defense Project. Corals are important. They create reef communities. They support underwater wildlife, and they are food for the body and soul. Higher than normal water temperatures are causing massive die-offs of coral. The healthy one is on the right and the bleached one is on the left. The primary threat to corals is the warming of our planet. This is our planet at night from space with sunrise on the horizon. This this thin, very thin strip is our atmosphere, and that protects us. Blankets our planet, traps heat, and keeps us warm and protects us from the bitter cold of space. Normally, the air has carbon dioxide in it. Right now, we're putting too much carbon dioxide into the air. And this excess carbon dioxide is trapping more heat, and the oceans are getting too warm for corals. But if we stop emitting carbon dioxide now, even if we do that, the Earth is still going to keep heating up. We need to remove the excess carbon dioxide. Our goal in this project is to create a new technology to remove excess carbon dioxide, one of many that are needed, from our atmosphere and use it to help corals, oysters, and reef wildlife. We are trying to mimic whiting events. These are huge events that you can see from space. Lake Ontario usually isn't light blue. It actually has little powdery crystals in it of calcium carbonate. And that causes that's a mineral that's limestone is made out of. So these whiting events can occur when algae bloom in calcium-rich water, making the water less acidic, and then tiny grains of calcium carbonate form. So we're trying to mimic that in the lab. We tried to make mini whiting events with saltwater algae, and this is at iMet, and we were able to do it there. And we were also trying to mimic these create carbon calcium carbonate with freshwater algae, and we were doing that at Horn Point with algae that we got from iMet. Thanks, iMet. And this is the system that we set up. We have two types of algae bioreactor systems, and in one system we measure the air going in and then through the algae system and then the air going out. And here's our little critters. These algae are tiny. They're like 5 to 10 micron. And so this is what I'm going to show you some data. This is a graph over time, and this is the carbon dioxide concentrations in our environmental chamber. And these black spikes are us walking into the chamber and breathing. Yes, we breathe out carbon dioxide. And then that's the air, the black line's the air going into the system. The orange line is a system that doesn't have any algae. And the green and the blue line is the systems with algae. And this was from October through December and then January through March. And as you can see, if I put the lines for 400 ppm, that's atmosphere, and then 200 ppm, our algae are actually removing more than 50%, more than half of the carbon dioxide out of the air. So our systems are trapping carbon dioxide. And then we ran tests to see if the carbon dioxide was actually dissolved into the fluid, into the water of the algae culture. And here you, on the x-axis, you have pH, which is a measure of acidity. If it's really acid, it goes down, gets smaller, and if it's more basic and less acid, it gets higher. So the liquid plant food that we are feeding our algae, and then the fluid in the system that didn't have any algae, didn't have very much dissolved carbon or inorganic carbon in it. This is seawater, and that's a kind of a reference we're using here. But when we look at our water coming out of our algae systems, we get a lot of dissolved inorganic carbon into the water. So not all the time, but sometimes we're even getting more than seawater, which is really cool. We get high values regardless of the type of algae bioreactor system we were using. Now then, but we're trying to make calcium carbonate. So we really need carbon to be in the form of carbonate ions. And so carbonate ions, bicarbonates predominate in the around seawater, but we want carbonates. So this is what this looked like with our liquid plant food, our fluid from the algae systems without algae, and our seawater. Not much carbonate at all. But when we look at our fluid coming off of the algae culture, carbonate ions were formed. So way to go, algae. Really trapping carbon in the fluid in a form that we can use to make calcium carbonate. Well, did we do it? That's the question. Well, we did. We combined our calcium-rich water, our carbonate-rich water, with calcium-rich water like a concentrated groundwater or seawater, and we made calcium carbonate. So we didn't make a lot. These are like little filters with a small amount that we sent off one set to for XRD analysis and found out that it was aragonite, in fact. But so we don't know how big this process will be. We're going to declare victory on this little tiny bit of precipitate, and we're working on making a lot more, believe me. And we want to make a lot more because our goal is to put this calcium carbonate that was using carbon trapped out of the air and put it into a synthetic coral and oyster habitat. And we are in the process of designing this new habitat, and our colleague at MICA is just an artist who does these incredible visions. And then he makes them real. So here's the mold to create this, our prototype of this habitat. And we're trying to get enough calcium carbonate to fill this up and test how strong it is. So this is a really exciting project. It's perhaps the most diverse and intellectually exciting work I've ever done. It's such a pleasure to work with all the people on this. And now we are testing if the process can be scaled up to build synthetic habitat that removes excess carbon dioxide. This is a picture of our vision where we hope to be 3 years from now or 2 years from now and then test it. So wish us luck. Stay tuned. Please stay engaged related to carbon capture and climate change and stay positive. There's a lot of people working on this all across the world. And I have a lot of hope and a lot of gratitude to the Bailey Wildlife Foundation for letting us participate in this grand endeavor. And so, and then finally, the third part, let me just check the time. And I'm doing okay, so we'll have time for questions. Is the public service announcement about COVID, and this is brought to you by Nights, Weekends, and UMSIs. We don't have a funder yet, and I'm again grateful to my colleagues who are working with me at IMET, at Chesapeake Biological Lab, and at Horn Point Lab, who, oh, you know what, I'm sorry, I just also wanna thank back here, I wanna thank the faculty and staff of all the UMSIs laboratories who have helped, many, many, who've helped with this project. I would be remiss to not acknowledge how much help that we have received from lots of different people. So back to the COVID story, which we are, this is shaping our lives now. And this is something that I think me and a lot of other scientists who just can't help but think about and apply data to this question. But where I'm have the honor to be working with folks from Johns Hopkins, IMET, CDL, and Horn Point again to try to combine our expertise across many different fields and explore the link between vitamin D deficiency and COVID-19. And we have, I'm only going to be telling you about what other people have said who are who have published before. So while we wait for a vaccine to protect against COVID-19, what can we do to keep us safe? And that was kind of my question when I started looking at this data, or looking at PubMed, which is an incredible resource. Of course, we follow the CDC guidelines. We can protect ourselves, protect others, protect jobs by slowing the spread of COVID-19, by washing our hands, covering our mouths and noses, and avoiding crowds and practicing social distancing. And I thank Russell for that reminder always. Is there anything else we can do? Well, yes, we can maintain a healthy lifestyle with regular physical activity, good nutrition and adequate rest that keep our immune systems bolstered. And yes, of course. And is there anything else we can do? We really want to know what we can do, if there's anything else we can do while we wait for those vaccines. Well, Dr. Fauci says to take vitamin D if you're deficient, and here's how to know. So there's CNN put this piece together. I thought it was really informative. And Dr. Fauci said, if you are deficient in vitamin D, as people over 65 has a higher incidence of that. He says that does have an impact on your susceptibility to infection. So I would not mind recommending, and I do it myself, taking vitamin D supplements. So people in high risk groups. Anyway, I'm just leave it there. I'm just leave it at Dr. Fauci's. Read the article, please. But I went back and I read this article by Michael Hollick, published in 1994. And this article really changed the way I think about nutrients and vitamin D especially. So he said, vitamin D is absolutely essential for the maintenance of a healthy skeleton throughout our lives. I knew I should take it related to osteoporosis, but I didn't know I should take it for so much else. He said, there is mounting evidence that vitamin D insufficiency and vitamin D deficiency in elderly people is a silent epidemic that results in bone loss and fractures. And many people take vitamin D supplements because of osteoporosis. So then he said, it is casual exposure to sunlight that provides most humans with their vitamin D requirement. And it didn't really sink in until I read this article that I'm kind of like a plant, that my skin, when I expose it to sunlight, it actually creates something, and it creates vitamin D that is important for every cell in my body. And I just think that was in the middle of COVID, how cool is that fact? How interesting and how important. So where do we get vitamin D in addition to the sun? Of course, we get it from the sun. UV light is needed. And the great thing, it's free. Skin pigmentation can block UV light. So people who have beautiful, strong skin pigments, actually that pigmentation keeps them from aging. And it also blocks UV light. So they may need a little more UV light to get a vitamin D dose, daily dose. And then too much UV light, we know, causes cancer. We really need to be careful about that. Another source of vitamin D is through our food. There are some foods that are rich in vitamin D, like fish, mushrooms, eggs, dairy that's fortified. But importantly, vitamin D is fat soluble. And this is what Rose taught me. And it's so important, and it's changed the vitamin D that I take. And that is, it needs to be, and then supplements, they work. Too many supplements can be toxic, so that's not good. But if you're in a situation where you need vitamin D, taking vitamin D with something fat so it dissolves and can be absorbed by your body, so olive oil, you know, something fatty is important. And so once we get this, either from the sun or from our food, vitamin D goes to our liver, or the pre-vitamin D, and then the liver creates these compounds that end up in other parts of our body that control lots of the kidney function, endocrine, bone and mineral actions. A lot of vitamin D has a role in our sleep. It's really an amazing, I can't stop reading about it. So, but what I found out, and because I'm aging now, I've been at UMSEES for over 20 years, and as I age, I learn that as our skin ages, it makes less vitamin D. So here's a graph, day on the x-axis, and concentration of vitamin D in the blood. And these folks were given a burst of light, UV light, and young people were able to make more vitamin D than older people. And this is from Dr. Hollick's paper, 1994 paper. And then he also goes on to say, seasonal changes, time of day, latitude, aging, sunscreen use, and melanin pigmentation can substantially influence the cutaneous, the skin production of vitamin D. Interestingly, latitude above 38 to 40 in wintertime, the UV light isn't strong enough to really get a good daily dose of vitamin D. And you can see this difference here, exposure time, hour of the day, and here's the how much of this pre-D that was formed in the skin. And in October in Boston, I would say in July in Boston, there's a lot of formation of this pre-D through the skin. And in October, there's not that much. So our skin makes less vitamin D during the winter, especially at high latitudes. So during the winter, and I would say especially like January, February, March, those are times to really want to those are times when the vitamin D, low levels of vitamin D occurs, put it that way. So, but this talk was entitled COVID. So is there a link between vitamin D and COVID? And there's actually quite a lot of papers out there talking about the potential link. And there are two that I would like to share with you that is actually based in data. And these folks at University of Chicago had a study of 489 people, and this is their conclusions. The relative risk of testing positive for COVID-19 was 1.77 times greater for patients with likely deficient vitamin D status compared with patients with likely sufficient vitamin D status. And they mean, their meaning of this was, these findings appear to support a role of vitamin D status in COVID risk. Of course, randomized clinical trials are needed. This is just come out in September. And then here's folks in Spain who looked at a population of people who were admitted to the hospital and found that vitamin D deficiency was found in 82% of the COVID-19 cases and 47% of population-based controls. And here's a graph from their paper, COVID-19 cases here, men in gray, women in white. And then those here is people who are supplementing with vitamin D. And these are people who are controls from a healthy population. So this study, so that's two studies, and but there are many two studies that suggest that vitamin D may be protective of COVID-19, and there are other studies published that suggest it's protective against influenza. So what can we do to make sure we get enough vitamin D in addition to a healthy lifestyle? There's fortunately, and one of the people behind this app is Dr. Hollick. There's an app for that. It's called D-Minder, and it allows you to track the sunlight exposure and how much vitamin D you could be synthesizing. So that is just one thought to leave with you. And again, on my third part, I just want to thank my kudos and gratitude to the men and women of science and medicine, especially those on the front line. People are trying so hard to figure out this global pandemic. This was yesterday. If I searched COVID-19 in PubMed, I got 72,000, almost 73,000 papers about COVID-19. This is incredible. In less than a year, really. So the effort to figure this out is huge and gives me so much hope. And I'm so thankful to be able to participate in this effort. And I'm very thankful for my collaborators to who are educating me a lot about really big and complicated things. So in any case, I just want to wrap up with just one thought about how do you tie all this stuff together. So what do these efforts on consensus, carbon capture, and COVID have in common? Besides this woman in science, it's not that. It's actually, what happened? Sorry. Oh, that's awful. I was doing so well. And then I hit the technical difficulty. So let's see. Let me try again. What do these efforts on consensus, carbon capture, and COVID have in common? Well, they are problems that people who work together can solve. I think that I'm so impressed with what we've been able to do together in the Oyster Futures program and the Coral Defense program. And my faith goes forward to all the medical professionals who are working so hard about COVID, that we're going to solve it. So that's my that's all I have, and I'll take questions. Rose, we can't hear you. You're on mute. Oh, I see a chat. Let's see.
Haven't you introduced your consensus building program to the White House?
No one's asked yet. But I can only hope, right? It's really amazing. And so if people would like to ask questions, can they just unmute themselves or type in the chat? Is that how it works on WebEx?
We can do either.
Okay.
But I encourage people to ask and then mute afterwards.
Hi, Liz. This is Fen. Enjoy your talk. I have a question about... Yeah, I was wondering the Synodesima strain that you grow there. Do you actually know the concentrations of the carbonate at the end when you have a high pH? Is there any way you can measure the concentration of carbonate?
The graph that I showed is in I believe we had milliequivalents per liter, and we also have it in milligrams per liter for carbonates. Yes.
Okay, that's good. Yeah.
Yes, it's amazing algae. It's really, it survived me. So it's very hardy.
Cynodismus is easy to grow.
Yes. Hard Thank to you kill. For sending me an easy one.
So Elizabeth, hi, how are you?
Hi, how are you?
Really enjoyed it. I have two questions. Actually, on the algae, obviously there have been a huge amount of studies on, you know, algae-based sequestration of CO2, right? And I think the conclusion is, and Yan Tao is here, unless you work with genetically modified algae that are much more efficient in terms of, you know, photosynthetic efficiency or some other metabolic pathway, it's not going to be very efficient. So I guess what you are adding here is like a different mechanism, right? The conversion of the so really extracting it out as opposed to recycling the CO2, right? So what about the efficiency of the process if you're going to think scaling it up to like global levels?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, that is exactly what we're trying to calculate right now. We ran two experiments called carbon trace experiments, where we're trying to measure how much carbon dioxide is going into the culture, how much is being trapped in the algae biomass, and then how much is coming out in the dissolved inorganic carbon. And then of what's coming out in the fluid in basically carbonates, how much of that are we able to precipitate? And we have some, we're getting better at precipitating, and we've figured out there, some of the factors that could be controlling precipitation, and that's, we're still doing the energy budget calculation to find out if we're, the cost of carbon that we're burning to run the system is actually more or less than the amount of carbon we're binding into calcium carbonate. So that's, you know, hopefully next month I will be able to run those numbers. Yeah.
And again, the scale of the production that you have to end up, you know, building in order to for this to have like the global atmospheric effect, you know.
Yes, it's, you know, this is not we like to say silver buckshot is going to solve. There's not going to be a silver bullet for pulling carbon dioxide out of the sky. We want a silver buckshot, and this constraint that the Bailey Wildlife Foundation of building a coral reef habitat and trying to make that habitat carbon negative, because right now sometimes people use concrete, which is not carbon negative. We really want to try to make carbon negative habitat. And in that process, we really hope we come up with a technology or see the ideas for new technologies that become more, you know, can be really scaled up to make a big dent. But we're keeping focused, eyes on the prize. That solar panel shipping container is what we're our kind of tactical work right now.
Right. Thank you.
Sure.
Elizabeth, it's Russell. I have a quick comment and then a question. Can I ask everyone who isn't speaking and mute themselves? There we go. We were getting some background. So one of the intriguing things about calcium carbonate is that you can turn it into a building material. And most people don't realize that somewhat under the radar screen somehow that 8% of carbon dioxide emissions globally come from cement production. So this could be a great solution. And actually, one of our ex-IMET graduate students has just joined a small biotech company in North Carolina that's working on bio-cement.
Cool.
So that could be an interesting follow-up. But I wanted to move to your vitamin D work. I've heard you talk about this a little bit before, and I can tell you I now take vitamin D every day after hearing you. But I'm intrigued by the next step. So if you had lots of funding for work on vitamin D, what would you be doing next to really nail this down and to get it out into the public domain?
Well, but I'd be doing exactly what we're proposing to do. And there's this wonderful database called Trinetics that is information from hospitals or centers, 52 centers around the country. It's de-identified, which means no one's personal information's in it. They have 1.8 million records of vitamin D levels in people's blood. And so that, I think exploring that and with Rose and Sook, and our colleagues at Johns Hopkins, and for the real physiology and medicine, and also a physician who's on the group. I don't want to just list everyone's names. Then we have our statisticians at UMCES, who are the big data statisticians to help. I think that is what I would my fingers are crossed. You know, we won't be able to have that work finished in time for this winter. We won't know if we will be funded, but I'm pretty sure we're going to keep doing something, even though we don't have money. But it would go a lot faster if we had people to help us and we could have it be funded. So we're definitely going to put that proposal in and really take it, hopefully a deep dive into the data and look for those physiological connections and processes that underlie vitamin D regulation, and then how that relates to the immune system and the response to COVID. So I think it's kind of my next passion. So we'll see where it goes.
Great, thank you. I see there's
hopefully a question the vaccine, and then we can, we're hoping the vaccine comes, and so that it'll just be something that is how interesting and science supportive information for general health, and not really a response to a crisis. That's my hope.
Well, and as you pointed out, it can help with flu potentially, and if the coronavirus vaccine ends up being somewhat short term, it could be a really useful supplement to a vaccine. But I see there's a question in the chat from Eric. Maybe Eric, you want to and put your question.
Okay. hi, Elizabeth. That was wonderful. Hi. Thank you for all of that. So you and I are both familiar with the oyster conundrum in the state of Maryland, and I'm wondering, do you feel comfortable opining about whether the legislation that came about from your oyster futures is being followed with the spirit in which your original group participated in it? And if it's not, what would you recommend?
I think I think we were off to a really good start, and then COVID happened. So we had one meeting of the commission where I participated, and then we couldn't meet in person. And one of the key things about Oyster Futures was the ability to meet in person, take breaks, talk to different groups, and really get to know each other as a human being and really understand where people are coming from. And we really lost that important glue to the process because of COVID, and also because of internet technology. Of some of our key participants, the commercial fishermen, the watermen who live on islands in southern counties that are away from cell phone, or they don't have good internet access, and they can't attend these meetings. They're not connected. It's not fair, and it's really making it very difficult for the process to work well, because they can't hear and we can't hear them, and we really need their input, and really need them to be fully engaged and to have their hopefully sharing their knowledge about the oyster resource, so that the model that we build has given the true sniff test. Like if the watermen who work on the water think that it does an okay job, good enough to help evaluate different options against each other, then that's really where we're trying to go. And we just can't do that without their input. So I'm feeling like that the intention of the bill, we can't evaluate your question because COVID has just really made it difficult. Yeah.
Your comment about being in the same room reminds me of interactions on environmental justice in Baltimore, having to do with what's going on in watersheds. And one of the faith leaders in West Baltimore said, it's very important to just be breathing the same air. Those were his words.
Yeah.
And we all got what he meant. And suddenly breathing the same air has a very different connotation now.
Yeah.
But it's sad. I hadn't thought about the role of just being in the same room with somebody has in reaching consensus.
Yes, and there's the and people's body language. It's there's a lot in the legs and feet. So you know, like this, even if everything was connected well, you can't really bump into someone in the hall and say, you know, I really appreciate what you said. You know, I've thought a lot about it since the last weekend, since the last meeting, and I've changed my mind. You know, like this, these kind of frank exchanges are, it's just, we're losing that. And I don't know what the legislature's going to do because we have a hard stop timeline for when we're supposed to deliver results to them and a consensus package of, so it's challenging. But the team that's working on it, I really enjoy working with the DNR and facilitators, and of course Mike Wilbert. And so it's you know, we're trying really hard. I'm seeing the behind the scenes people trying really hard to make this work. So
good to hear.
I'm hopeful. Yeah.
Okay, any more questions for Elizabeth? I have trouble seeing the chat on the chat questions on.
I haven't seen anything more come through in chat.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, neither. A Zoom meeting, or I'm sorry, a web meeting that ends early? That's. 4 minutes early, that never happens with me, so this is good.
Well, it's not because all of it was absolutely fascinating. And I'm glad that you're being recorded. I'd love to see the slide again on the consensus building.
Go ahead.
I think that Bill Denison has used that on audiences. I seem to feel I've been in a Bill Denison meeting where he's used that that construct for building consensus. I can't remember what it was.
There's actually lots of different consensus type processes, and this one was actually specially designed and was kind of almost commissioned by the Florida legislature. The facilitators were asked to work on processes that had a lot of conflict. There were enough conflict and importance that it was really important to kind of keep it out of the legal system, but you know, enough conflict around groundwater that there was a lot of public interest in it. And so it's a very specific process. There's a very, I wouldn't say strict, but very prescribed way of doing these options. And it's really well thought out and well tested. So I don't want to say that there aren't other ways of getting to consensus. There's lots of different ways, but the only one that I've been through, you know, actually, interestingly, the stakeholders came to consensus about the oyster the same month that was 150 years anniversary of the Maryland Natural Resources Police that that was established because of conflicts over the oyster in Maryland.
Wow.
So, you know, people said it took us 2 years to come to consensus, but, you know, after 150 years of conflict, you know, a consensus in 2 years isn't bad. And I think that we could have done it a lot faster. And, you know, you can always do things better the second or third time. So,
well, I think the powerful part of that, too, is being able to do those predictions over 25 years, which required your modelers to come through for you.
Yeah, I was the larval transport modeler, and then my connectivity matrices fed into the Mike Wilberg's full population dynamics model, and that allowed us to simulate forward in time and also simulate in space. So this the stakeholders wanted us to put oysters on this bar in this part of the chop tank and then open this area to fishing or do restoration on these areas. And so as the larval transport model helped connect the oyster population across those different spaces. And then Mike made every population on every bar. So it was a truly spatially a spatial model for forecasting populations. It was definitely an NSFE cutting edge model. It was cool. So yeah.
Fantastic. So I'll ask again, any more questions from anyone in the audience? And if not, this has been really interesting. Each of your components was gripping. So we thank you for that. And I hope to see you again soon. I know I will.
Yes, you will. You will. You can't get away from me yet. Thank UMCES for this. I'm very grateful to UMCES for the opportunity to work on research that serves the state of Maryland and is so fun.
And I'd also like to thank, well, I'd like to thank everyone from IMET for coming, but I'd also like to thank all our colleagues from, all our partner colleagues for joining us today as well. All right.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.